الحمد لله، أحمده وأستعينه وأستغفره، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن نبينا وسيدنا وقدوتنا وإمامنا محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخاتم الأنبياء والرسل، أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة، وبرسالته تم الإسلام وكمل. My dear brothers in Islam, all praise be to Allah. I praise Him alone. I seek His forgiveness. I testify that there is no one worthy of being worshipped but Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. He completed the message, and by him all the religion of Islam was perfected. My dear brothers in Islam, the topic today is regarding some narrations, whether they are hadiths of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or hadiths which are attributed to him falsely, or whether they are statements of the companions radiallahu anhum, or statements which are attributed to them falsely, or statements by the students of the companions, may Allah be pleased with them all, or statements that have been falsely attributed to them. We have to make sure of two things, and I am giving an example today in those narrations speculating things happening in the Muslim nation. And those things, if they are speculated by a true hadith, and the meaning of those true hadiths have been defined by the scholars, then inshallah, it is safe to take those narrations into consideration and to make lessons out of them. If they are proven to be authentic, and if they are explained by the scholars, not by anyone. Unfortunately, Muslims nowadays have confused things. They have confused the true narrations with the false narrations. They have confused the true meanings of the narrations with the false meanings of narrations. You see, everything is according to desire and thinking, and what matches what's already in your feelings. You see, it's by this you are not following the Sunnah. You are following your feelings. You are following what your mind is telling you. But you think you are following the hadiths of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the statements of the companions and so on. Unfortunately, for example, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have mentioned in several hadiths in Sahih Muslim and other narrations, he has mentioned things which will happen in Iraq, in Sham, which is now called Syria and Lebanon and those places, in Egypt. They are mentioned in some true hadiths and in some weak narrations. weak narrations, whether about the Prophet ﷺ himself or about the companions or the students of the companions. So what is our position? Our position is not to hasten to the meaning that occurs in our mind, or to the meaning which is explained by people who are not actually Islamic scholars. They might have some knowledge, they might have a lot of knowledge in some fields of Islam, but this is not the definition of the scholar in Islam. The scholar is someone who has studied in a certain methodic way under the scholars themselves. He studied under the scholars until those scholars told him, you are now a scholar, go and teach the people, go and give fatwa, go and make ijtihad. As Imam Malik rahimahullah said, I did not dare to give a fatwa until 40 scholars in my time told me, oh Malik, it is time that you go and give fatwa. And his student Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, his student Imam Shafi'i, when he was 13, 14 years old, he was already a scholar. And the scholars knew him. So they told him, go ahead, you are a scholar, you can give fatwas, you are a mujtahid. Nowadays, what is the definition of the scholar? No, it's not like that, unfortunately. It's not like that. You find someone who has been living in the West all his life, reading from books here and there, accumulating some kind of knowledge and this about different materials in Islam. And because he has acquired that much, and because people around him know almost nothing about Islam, some of them don't even know that they have to pray 5 prayers. And I'm not speaking of my imagination. I've been in America for more than 15 years, and I have dealt with those people. They don't know that it is obligatory to make 5 prayers. And their parents are Muslims, but they are careless. The last thing on their mind to teach their children is about Islam. They are busy in their dunya, running after wealth and materials and things like that. You can find no basic difference between them and the kafirs who are living for this life only. And therefore, those people, if someone comes and tells them it is obligatory that you make 5 prayers, and then he tells them the prayer has, for example, 13 pillars, and it has this much obligations and this much sunnahs in it, or desirable actions in it, he will classify you as a scholar. He doesn't know, you see. Therefore, unfortunately, especially the young people who have good intentions, but good intentions is not sufficient. You have to have the good intention, but you have to seek the right action. Those are the two conditions that are mentioned in the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam repeatedly. بَلَا مَنْ أَسْلَمَ لِلَّهِ. This is the intention. وَهُوَ مُحْسِنٌ. While he is doing good in his action. Muhsin, ihsan, to do good. You see? If you do something that hurts Islam, and you say that this is fasting, or this is such and such, this is not the correct action. No one has the right to do things in the name of Islam which bring more evil for Islam and Muslims than bring advantages. This is an agreed upon rule in Islam. Islam is the religion of maslaha. By maslaha we mean what the Sharia have specified as maslaha. As Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said, حَيْثُمَا كَانَتِ الْمَصْلَحَةِ فَثَمَّ شَرْعُ اللَّهِ. Wherever there is maslaha, maslaha means advantage for Muslims, then that is the Sharia of Allah. That is the Sharia of Allah. Why? Because Allah is Al-Hakim. Al-Hakim is what? The wise. What does it mean? It means that every order that he has ordered is for a maslaha. And everything that he has forbidden, he has done that for a maslaha. We might not know it now. So what? Who are we to judge the rule of Allah? Our position from the rule of Allah is to submit and not to find any harsh feelings in the heart, any hatred, any hesitance. Finding hesitance in your heart in regards to the Sharia of Allah is the quality of hypocrites. Allah said, "Fi qulubihim marad, fazadahum Allah marada." There is a disease in their heart, and Allah gave them more disease in their heart as a punishment for them. They doubted when the believers did not doubt. They doubted. They were hesitant when the believers were not hesitant. So according to their sin, their great sin, which could be also kufr sometimes, Allah led them more astray, go more astray, further. This is a punishment from Allah. As Allah said about Thamud, فَلَمَّا زَاغُوا أَزَاغَ اللَّهُ قُلُوبَهُمْ. When they turned away from the right path that has been shown to them, Allah made their hearts go further away from the right path as a punishment for that. Therefore, my dear brothers, let not everyone think that if the truth is shown to him and he becomes hesitant or doubtful or whatever, that he might have another chance and he might not. How do you know? How do you know you are going to have another chance? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has threatened in his book, he threatened in many verses. He said that Allah becomes as a shield between your heart and faith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will become as a shield, so who can guide you? If Allah stands in between you and guidance, how can you achieve guidance? You see, this is in the book of Allah. When Allah said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَجِيبُوا لِلَّهِ وَلِلْرَسُولِ إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ لِمَا يُحْيِيكُمْ, then he said, وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِهِ. Oh, you have faith, answer the call of Allah and Messenger when he calls you to that in which there is real life for you, the life of paradise. and the good life in this life also. And you must know, Allah says, that Allah can stand in between you and your heart, so that your heart will not accept guidance. The companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "O Messenger of Allah, is there someone better than us? We became Muslims with you. We made jihad with you." He said, "Some people who will come later on after you, they will have faith in me despite the fact that they did not see me." So this is a great glad tidings for the believers, that they should not be hopeless. In Islam, if you become hopeless, this is against Tawheed. Against Tawheed, because that means your trust in Allah is shaky. Or you don't have any trust in Allah. Otherwise, why did you become despaired? "Oh, the enemies are doing this to us and that and this and that and this and that." We can do our best to prevent the enemies of Allah if we seek the right knowledge of Islam and act upon what we learn in the right way. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who listen and follow the best. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه. الحمد لله وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، وأشهد أن نبينا محمدا عبده ورسوله. Another hadith regarding this is the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, where he said, "My nation is like rain. It is not known its beginning better or its end." You see, that replies on those who have despair. And this is very dangerous to feel that Muslims nowadays, there is no use of them. They have all gone astray. And that's it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned against that. He said, "من قال هلك الناس فهو أهلكهم." He who says that the people now are so drifted away from Islam that there is no use in them, then he is the cause for their drifting. Why? Because of his negative attitude. You see? And in another true narration, the same hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, "فَهُوَ أَهْلَكُهُمْ" not أَهْلَكَهُمْ but أَهْلَكُهُمْ, then he is the most deviant amongst them. You see? He finds himself that he is on the top of faith and everyone else is junk. Then he is the most junk. You see, this is not Islam. Alhamdulillah, we have trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Inna hadha ad-deen bada'a ghariban wa sayaudu ghariban fatuba lil-ghuraba." That this religion, just like it started strange, Tawheed was strange because people were worshipping idols or cross or something like that. Tawheed was strange. And other aspects of Islam, many aspects at that time was strange. Not everything, of course. Because the Arabs had some good morals and they had generosity, they had braveness, they had this, they had that. And not only the Arabs, the rest of the people. You see. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that this religion will come back again as strange, that means there will be people acting exactly upon what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his companions were acting upon in his time. And therefore they'll be strange again to the people. They'll be strange again. What do you think? You think if you live amongst Muslims and try to compromise with them everything, except few things that you do secretly, which is different, other than that you compromise with them everything. You see, this is not being strange. This is not being strange, you see. Even though you are making your prayers, giving zakat, doing good things, doing a lot of good things, but this is, you are not strange by your faith, you see. Your faith in Allah has to be different. Has to be the way that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions had faith in Allah. All other articles of faith have to be the same. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in his book, فَبِهُدَاهُ مُقْتَدِهُ. Seek guidance with their guidance. Okay. Seek guidance with their guidance. And he said, فَإِنْ آمَنُوا بِمِثْلِ مَا آمَنْتُمْ بِهِ. When they become faithful in the same way that you, Muhammad, and your companions have faith, then they are faithful. You cannot have faith in angels in the way you want. You cannot have faith in the hereafter in the way you want. Not only issues of faith, everything in Sharia has to be according to the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who listen and follow the best. اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا وعافنا وتب علينا وأصلح لنا شأننا كله. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين. اللهم وفق ولاة أمور المسلمين لما تحب وترضى. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد وسلم تسليما وأقم الصلاة.